us to remember our church family. We have so many that are hurting. We have so many that are ill. We have so many that still are deciding to stay home because of the virus. I would encourage each and every one of you to take this time and send them a letter. If you miss their face or miss seeing them, would you just let them know that you're thinking of them and praying for them and praying all is well with them. I also want to ask you to remember Tom Haynes. He took a fall this week, and it was a pretty nasty fall. Luckily, he didn't break anything, but he is in a lot of pain, so if you remember him, and lift him up in prayer and remember him. And I'm sure he'd love to hear from you if any of you would like to contact him as well. Also remember Rose. She's really struggling. She's going through the dialysis and everything with that is going well, but it's like zapped every bit of energy she has from her. So would you remember her and just lift her up in prayer as well? And I'm sure every one of us has people that we need to pray for, and if you would lift them up in this time. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come into your house. This opportunity to worship you and to share your word and to encourage each other. And so, Father, right now, would you just be with each and every one here this morning? Be with those who could not be here. Father, we just lift each one of them up to you, and we just pray for them and their families and all that they may be going through, or if they're just simply afraid. Just be with them, encourage them, just help to strengthen them, Father. Father, we lift up Tom to you, and we just pray, Father, that you would just touch his body in a mighty, miraculous way and bring healing to his body. Father, we pray that the pain will cease, that he will be able to rest comfortably and heal well and be back to doing his normal activities. Father, we lift up Rose to you and pray for her, and pray, Father, that you would just continue to help her in this time of adjustment as she's going through dialysis and as she's tired and weak. And Father, just be with her in this. And Father, we lift up Tony to you. We ask you to continue to be with him and in this time. Be with Barbara as she cares for him. Father, I know every one of us walked in this room with burdens, either for ourselves or for family members or friends. And so, Father, we lift all of those up to you right now and ask you to work in those in mighty, mighty ways. And, Father, as we come to this time that we're going to be sharing your truth, your word, Father, I just pray that you would help to open our ears and our hearts to your truth. Help me to present this truth in a way that impacts us, challenges us. And Father, would you just remove any barrier that stands in the way of your truth coming forth? And to you, we give all glory and praise and honor. It's in the name of your Son that we ask all of these things, and all the people say. This morning we're going to continue in 1 Peter, we'll be in chapter 5. This morning we're going to talk about one of those subjects that everyone kind of wants to slide under the table when we start talking about it. When we start talking about submission and we start talking about humility, it's kind of like, I don't know about that. It's a hard subject. sermon probably 6 or 7 times this week. Cynthia is going to look at my trash can in my office and be like, what happened in here? Because I just wasn't happy with it. It just wasn't coming out right. And so I'd rewrite it and change it, and then I still wouldn't like it, so I'd rewrite it and change it. And anyway, I'm going to just pray that the Lord takes my words and uses them for you. Because I still don't know that it's where I want it, but last night just was like, this is where we're going. Lord, I'm leaving it in your hands, Holy Spirit. Use it. Speak your truth. Let the people hear it. And I think one of the reasons that I struggled with it is because, as I've told you before, I have to wrestle with this before you hear it. And so the Lord was wrestling with me in this as well. Because it's a hard subject. It's a hard thing to do. And yet, it's the very thing Peter is going to stress in these three verses we're going to read this morning. He stresses the importance of it. We talked about last week, if you'll remember, Peter's words to the believers, that these are what you need to be doing until the end comes. They're to be praying. They're to be loving fervently one another. And to be serving one another. And those three things are what we're called to do as believers until he comes. And today, Peter's going to add another layer to that. In that, in your praying, in your loving, in your serving, you're to walk humbly. And so this morning, as we look at this, I pray that we can begin to see why it's so important for us. And why it's so important that we understand this and we put it into practice in our lives. Because if we don't, we're going to see here as we read our verses that God is opposed to the proud. How many of you want to have God opposed to you? I don't think anybody would say they want to be. But he gives grace to the humble. What a powerful reminder for us. What a powerful thing that we need to learn. And the earlier we learn it, the better off we're going to be. And as hard as it is, it's vital in our life as believers to apply it and to live it in our lives. Let's get his word before us this morning. We're going to begin in verse 5. You younger men, likewise, be subject to your elders, and all of you clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, for God is opposed to the proud and gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on him, because he cares. What a powerful, powerful three verses. And as you look at these verses, you have to take it in context, because Peter, as you'll remember, walked with Christ. He saw this example in Christ. He saw Christ do this, repeatedly through his life. You see, Christ came. He came to be a ransom for every one of us, even to the point of death, death on the cross, so that you and I could have our sins forgiven, so that you and I could walk free. That's walking free humbly. He's God. He could have just snapped his fingers, wiped us all out. But no, he chose to come as a man and live as a man on this earth. He knew his calling. He knew what he was here for. And he lived it, and he preached it, and he taught it. And just to make sure the disciples got it, at the Last Supper, he dons a towel and a basin of water and goes around washing the feet of the disciples. Powerful, powerful images of submission. And Peter comes along and says, this is to be a part of who you are as believers. So as we look at this, I pray that each and every one of us, and I'm including myself in this, that we learn this, that we apply it, and that we begin to walk humbly before our God. As I was preparing this sermon, there's a couple of quotes that I came across that are just little, but they stop and make you think. The first one I came across was from D.L. Moody, and he said, "Be humble, or you'll stumble." That one's an easy one to remember. Be humble or you'll stumble. And the other one was by Craig Rochelle, and that he said, "Pride is about my glory, while humility is about God's glory." Powerful quotes. Short, but they get your attention and they get the point. You see, the one thing that becomes very clear as you read through these passages and as we've gone through 1 Peter and throughout the Old and New Testaments is that there's a huge difference between pride and humility. Pride is about me. Pride is about my self-sufficiency, my self-reliance. Pride stands there and says, I don't need God's instructions. I can handle this myself. Pride can even lead us to reject God's authority and do our own thing. Pride leads us to refuse to trust in God. And it leads us to thinking more highly of ourselves than we ought. And that's exactly one of the reasons why it is so important as believers we learn this idea, this concept of humility. Because nothing will turn off someone who's not a believer than for that prideful person who calls themselves a Christian to be an example of the exact opposite. That's where we get the word hypocrisy from. Hypocrites. You say you're a Christian, but you're so wrapped up in pride in yourself and your own thing that I don't see Christ in any of that. Humility, on the other hand, is all about submission. condition. And as I was thinking about this term humility, I immediately thought of Proverbs 3. Because I think it's great advice for us. Beginning in verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean upon your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be a healing to your body and a refreshment to your bones. Honor the Lord from your wealth and from the first of all your produce, so your barns will be filled with plenty, your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe his reproof. For whom the Lord loves, he reproves, even as a father corrects the son. Let those words sink in. Trust in the Lord with your whole heart. Do not lean upon your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Do you see that? Even in those two verses, there is no I anywhere there, except for you to put your trust in the Lord and to acknowledge him. That's humility. That's what Peter is getting at here. And right off the bat in verse 5, Peter begins. Two difficult words for us. Submit. Clothe yourself with humility. We talked a few weeks ago about this whole idea of submission. We're to submit to the Lord. And if the Lord is leading and guiding us, people can see that. People will recognize that. But if we're not submitting to the Lord, people will see that pride in us. And I love how even before he gets to us, if you go back to verse 1 through verses 4, Peter's words are to the elders, to the pastors, to the leaders of the church. And he tells them they're to do three. He tells them they're to shepherd the flock. He tells them that they're to provide oversight. And he tells them they're to be examples to the flock. So as you read through this, this idea of humility is not just for you. I have to walk in that. I have to be the example of that to you. And I pray God will help me to do that every day. Because I don't want to be prideful. I don't want it to be about me. want my life to be a reflection of Him. He then moves them to from the idea of pastor leader to in verse 5, talking about you younger men likewise be subject to your elders. And as I was researching this, because I'm like, is this a continuation of his thought in the first few verses, or has he like made a switch? And this, can I just tell you, the scholars aren't sure. As you research it, they go both ways. So I would say it applies to both. You younger people, if you want to talk about it in terms of pastorship, in terms of leaders, you young leaders, be subjected to those who are elders, who are over you. Learn from them. Watch them. Hear them teach you. Don't be resistant to that. Be submissive to them. Learn from them so that when you move into a place of leadership, you have learned what you need to learn to do it. Likewise, you younger people, look around you. You are surrounded by people that are older than you, that have lived life longer than you, have had more life experiences than you. And they can teach you a lot if you will let them. They can help you avoid those pitfalls that we all fell into. They can help you learn. We've lived longer. We know more. We've been in God's Word longer. We know those things. We have hopefully submitted ourselves to Christ and are being that example to you, so learn from us. Now, in saying that, I'm going to put a little caveat on that. We still have to be careful because there are some who are older than us that are more immature than even some kids. I don't know how to put that. So be subject to those who you can learn from, who can encourage you, who can help you, who've been there, who know. Let them instill their wisdom and their knowledge in you. And if you will allow them to do that, you will be more successful and have more knowledge in your job and in your life. One of the things that I enjoy in my second job as an X-ray tech is being able to teach others. I remember when I walked into radiology, I knew nothing and I was scared to death. I didn't want to touch someone. I didn't want to do anything. I didn't want to make a mistake. And I'm sure every one of you can apply that to whatever position you're in. And you have those people who have been around a lot longer than you who come along and say, "It's okay. It's okay, you can do this. You're not going to hurt them if you touch them. It's okay to touch them." It's okay. Look, I'm going to help you. Here's how you do this. Here's how you set your technique. Here's what you do. When you walk into that situation that just takes your breath away, when you walk into that trauma and you're like, let me show you what to do. You can do this. And so now, all of that stuff that I learned when I was 18, 19, 20 years old, and more, Because I'm still learning. I now can instill that into those who are in school now, who are learning. And I enjoy that. I enjoy taking people who have walked into MRI for the first time and begin to teach them and train them and all the things that is involved. The same is true in ministry. I love to see those young people who are taking classes and beginning their process of learning. I love to see that, and I want to encourage them, and I want to be there in any way that I can to help them. Because it's a daunting task. But you can do it. But Peter doesn't just stop there with this whole idea of younger and older, or younger and elders. Because then in verse 5, he says, and all of you. So no matter where you're at in this category, this applies to you. And all of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. For God is opposed to the proud, but gives Now, if you'll remember, Peter is addressing this letter to the believers in Asia Minor. They're in the middle of that Greco-Roman period, and in this period, it was frowned upon to be humble. They despised it. And if you're trying to walk in humility, to them, it was a sign of weakness. Fast forward 21 centuries. Or really 20 centuries, I guess. We have a whole population that's in this same mindset. I'll show you. You're going to do what I say or else. You may want to walk in humility, but I'm going to walk all over you if you do. And if you go back and as you read through 1 Peter, he tells us as believers, we will face trials. We will face persecution. So in light of that, Peter is saying, even if that's happening to you, you continue to walk in humility before your God. One of the greatest things we could do to leave God to be opposed to us is to walk in arrogance and walk in pride. As I was contemplating these words, I thought of the passage in Philippians where the Apostle Paul tells us to do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit. But with humility of mind, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. Would that not change our society? Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. What would our lives look like if we did that? What would our lives look like? church look like? What would our society look like? But Peter doesn't end that there. He adds these words that are found in Proverbs. God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Don't miss that. Don't just read over that. Because what Peter is doing here with those verbs is present tense. So here's how it could be read. God is continually opposing those who are proud and continually giving grace to those who are humble. I certainly don't want God opposing me. I certainly don't want to be on that end of things. I want to walk in His grace and His mercy. Then in verse 6, Peter adds, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. The other place in Scripture where the mighty hand of God is referred to is as Moses is leading the Israelites out of Egypt, out of their suffering. When we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, we are saying to Him, I bow to your wisdom. I bow to you and to your truth. I give myself to you totally, God. Use me. Guide me. Lead me. Because I know your mighty hand will protect me, will lead me, will guide me. And you will be faithful to me no matter what. And because of that, I gladly submit my life to you. Wow. No matter what happens, no matter what the cost, God, I trust you. I trust your hand to guide and lead me. I'm not going to lean on my own understanding. I'm not going to take control. I'm not going to grab a hold of this. I am going to submit it to you because I trust you will do more than I will do. Then he adds verse 7. Casting all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. I think sometimes one of the dangers we do is we take verse 7 is a standalone. I'm to cast all my anxiety upon him because he cares for you. But as you read through this, I don't think you can take that verse alone. I think it ties directly back to walking humbly with the Lord. You see, as we choose to walk humbly each day, whatever burden, whatever thing happens, whatever trial comes our way, we take that and we cast it on the Lord. Don't miss that. Don't miss that. So when that unexpected trial comes, when that person comes and says something mean to you, when something goes the wrong way, when everything breaks all at once in your home, cast your anxiety, cast your cares upon the Lord. Why? Because He is the faithful Creator. Going back to the end of chapter 4, He is our faithful Creator. We can entrust our souls. He knows us better than we know ourselves. He knew us as we were being formed in our mother's womb. He knows every hair that's on our head. He knows anything and everything that happens to us. Nothing catches Him by surprise. So because of that, because He's faithful, because He loves me, because He cares for me, I gladly choose to put my cares and anxieties. We have so many in our society today that are walking in fear. They're walking in fear of the coronavirus. They're walking in fear of all of the rioting and all the crazy stuff that's happening all across the world and in the United States. And rather than casting that on the Lord, they choose to hold on to it. And they choose to walk in fear. And they choose to let those situations control everything they do. Instead of casting it on the Lord and trusting Him. I'm going to stop there. We'll continue on this evening. But there is so much in these three verses. And I told you, I've rewritten this thing like 7 times. And I still don't know that I said what I really want to say. But let me encourage you today and throughout this week, go back and read these verses. Let them sink in. Let the Holy Spirit challenge you. To walk humbly, to be humble. When He shows you those areas of your life where there's pride, where there's this selfishness, where there's this dependence on self over dependence on God, repent of it. And ask Him to help you to walk in humbleness. You see, we serve a very great and mighty God. The one who holds the universe in His hands. The one who's created everything. The one who loved us so much that He sent His only begotten Son. As a ransom for you and me. This same God loves me, cares for me, has my best interest at heart. He's not asking me to jump through hoops. He's not asking me to do the impossible. What He's saying to me is, trust me. Love me. Love love others. Serve one another. And walk humbly, not pridefully. Walk humbly with me. Learn from me. Learn from my ways. Let me use you to change not only yourself, but to change those around you. Because God's glory is what each of us as believers should see. It's not about us. It's not about what we've done. It's not about what we have accomplished. Because God gave us all of those abilities to do it. It's about Him. Trust Him and walk in humility. Let's pray. Father, this morning, I don't know if I've done this justice. And Father, I know that your Holy Spirit can do more than anything I say or do. But Father, right now, would you challenge each and every one of us and those who will hear this online? Will you challenge us to walk humbly, to walk in humility, to deal with the pride and arrogance that's in our lives? Will you challenge us to submit to you, the one who is faithful, the one who never changes, the one we can trust, the one we believe in? Father, will you help each and every one of us to do that? Father, as we leave this place, let us be an example of you to others. Father, may others see you in us. And Father, may we see others through your eyes. Father, will you help to transform us and conform us more and more into the image of your Son? That's what you desire of us. Help us not to flippantly say we're a Christian, but rather let us live out that we truly are Christ. We're your examples to others. Father, go with us this week. Lead and guide the way as we put our trust in you and as we cast our every care upon you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for caring for us. And Father, we ask all of these things.